Welcome to the next practical class of natural language processing. In this class, we are going to look at different techniques that are useful in natural language processing and how we can implement it using the NLTK, that is the natural language toolkit in Python. For execution of this practical, I would be making use of the Jupyter notebook, which is IDE for executing Python program. You may use the IDE which is preferred by you, like the IDLE or any other and Python IDE can be used by you, right? So for using the NLTK toolkit, you need to import the NLTK module in Python, and for that there is a command import NLTK. So when you execute this particular command, the NLTK module is activated, right? And you can download the NLTK tool module if it is not available with you or on your system by using the nltk.download command in this IDE, or you can download it by using the pip install command through the command prompt. So when you execute this particular thing, it opens a pop-up window. When it is executed, you will see a pop-up window showing as NLTK downloader. Therein you will find the different things that are available in the NLTK, and it would show as red or pink color, highlighted with red or pink color, if these packages or these modules are not installed. So just select all and then click on download, so it would download these packages and install. If it is showing green, like in my system, that means all these things are already installed, all packages are already installed, and you don't need to download it again. So you can just close the window. If it is not there, then you can download it from this window also, right? So once you have downloaded the NLTK package or the NLTK module, then you can use it for writing programs for NLP, right? So the next thing that you need to do, as we have already imported the NLTK toolkit as it was available, you need to import the OS module. So by writing import OS, now this OS module provides the functions or different functionalities which are useful for interacting with the operating system, or different operating system functionality can be used over here by importing this particular module. So we use import OS. Then there are different kind of corpuses available in the NLTK toolkit. That corpus are nothing but the body of text wherein there is a huge amount of data available, and this can be text of medical journals, it can be text like an example of presidential speeches, or any other data in English language is available in NLTK corpus. So this is basically a body of text which is available in NLTK. So you can execute it, so it would import the OS module and the NLTK.corpus, the corpus from NLTK, right? You can also create your own data or your own text by writing it in inverted quotes, a string type. You can add paragraph, you can add sentence, you can add words. So I have created a sentence, two sentence, combination of two sentence, and stored it in a variable x. So this variable will have this particular string kind of data, which consists of two sentences or two questions, and that you can see the type. So anything which is written within inverted quotes, single or double, is considered to be string in Python. So when you execute this, it would also show the type. I have used the type command to get the type of x variable, so it would show you the type of x, that is str, that is string, right? Then we have a terminology technique known as tokenization. So tokenization is basically dividing the given input text into individual words or into individual sentences, right? So you can separate the given text by different words or individual words or by a sentence, right? So for that purpose, we use tokenization, and there are two kind of tokenizers that are the word tokenizers and the sentence tokenizers. The word tokenizers basically divide the given text into individual words, whereas the sentence tokenizer divide the given text into different sentences, right? So in one token, there would be one sentence. Okay. So for that, we have functionalities word tokenize and sent tokenize for word tokenization and sentence tokenization, which are available in the NLTK toolkit. So from, we need to import these two. So from nltk.tokenize, we import word underscore tokenize and sentence underscore tokenize, so send tokenize. So this command is used to import these two tokenizers. And then you can store, you can use these functions. You can call this function and apply it on our text and store the result in Z. So you'll get Z equals to word underscore tokenize. You will get word underscore tokenize. So Z will store the value of all the word tokens which are available in this particular text. Similarly, you can use the sentence tokenizer as sent underscore tokenize and apply it to the given sentence which we have created and store the result in Y. So you will get Y, inside Y you will get all sentences as tokens. So you will get two sentences over here like this. So when we execute this, you see that when we print Z, so inside Z you can see that all the words, individual words, are separated as tokens, even the punctuation marks also, right? So hello, Sagar, comma, then how, and these are the different tokens that are word tokens. Okay, similarly, when we applied sentence tokenizer, that is send tokenize on X, it divided the given text into sentences. So the first token is consisting of the first sentence as hello, Sagar, how are you, and the second is where were you these days, right? So it has divided the given text into two sentences. So this is the work of sentence tokenizer, right? Similarly, another example, I have created a string variable s and I have assigned data as Python is an awesome language to it. And again, I have used word tokenizer and then I am printing the tokens. So it has divided the given text into individual tokens, words, right? Then just let's have a look at the corpora which is provided by the NLTK. So we'll see what are the different functionalities and different kind of data and files which are provided by this particular corpora, that is the NLTK corpora. And you can see these are the different files or functionalities which are available, like this is the abc.zip folder, then alpino, alpino.zip. These are different examples of files that are available. There is again a file somewhere called as brown. So this is a brown file, brown.zip, brown.tie, brown.zip. So these are different files and functionalities that are available in this particular corpora. These are different than stateunion.zip, state union, that text. So these are different text available in WordNet in this particular corpora of NLTK. So now let us consider here, I have considered an example of the brown date file which is available. So let us take brown in consideration and look at the different words that are available in brown. So for that, what we'll do, we'll import this brown file from the NLTK corpus. So we write from nltk.corpus import brown, and then by using the word command, we'll find the different words that are available in this particular corpus, right? So brown.words, it gives us these are the starting words, and there are many more words over here. So the, Fulton, county, grand, jury, said, and so on. There are long amount of words, number of words available in this particular thing. So these are examples. So we have obtained the words, starting few words from this brown. Now let's look at another field, that is Gutenberg file IDs. So these are the different IDs, and it will show you the different files ID which are available in this particular thing. So we write nltk.corpus that Gutenberg.file IDs, and it would fetch the file IDs, different files that are available. So these are the different files that are available in this Gutenberg right? So these are the austin.ema.txt. So these are the different text files that are available in this particular Gutenberg purpose. Now let us open a file called as Bible dash KJV, which is a text file which is available in this particular Gutenberg, right? So we'll use Bible dash KJV dot text. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll use the word from this particular file and then we'll print, store it in Bible, and then we are printing it, right? So when we execute this particular thing, you see again there are different words which are available. So the starting thing over here is a opening square bracket, and then the King James Bible and so on. These are the starting words which are available in this particular file, right? Now suppose you want to print the first 100 words from this particular file. For that we make use of for loop. So here we use for words. So words is used as an iterative variable. So for words in Bible, that is each word in Bible which starts from 0 to 100, that is 100 minus 1, so 0 to 99 will be loop. So it would print the words, whatever is the word, it would print it the words. And then we have already, you know, that for separating this word we are using a separator as space, and at the end again we are using this space. So this is a print function which is used in Python. So these are the different parameters. By default this separator is space and end is a new line, so we have changed it to space and then again a space, right? So when we print it, you can see that the complete 100 words, the starting 100 words over in this file are printed over here, right? So these are the, you can see that the first word was a square bracket, then the King James Bible, and then the old again, like that. So these are the first 100 words from this particular file. Now let us use our own word data and then provide it to NLTK for tokenization purpose. So here I have created NLP string data. So I have added a multi-line string. So these three inverted quotes are used to add the multi-line strings. So you can add the text in multi-line. Everything will be considered as the same string paragraph, right? So I have added this text and stored it into NLP variable. And now when I'll execute this, it would store this particular data into NLP. And if I want to know the type of NLP, I would use the function type and then give input as NLP. So it would tell me that this is a string. As I said, that triple inverted quotes, anything within triple inverted quotes is a multi-line string. So it is string. And then now we will again make use of word tokenize to find the different tokens in this given paragraph, right? So we have applied it to different files and now to this our own data, right? So what we'll do, we'll again import the nltk.tokenize, and then from nltk.tokenize we'll import word underscore tokenize, and then we'll store this words into nlp underscore tokens by calling the function word underscore tokenize on nlp, and then it would be stored in these tokens, and then we'll print the different tokens that are obtained in nlp underscore tokens. So these are the tokens that are available in this particular file that I have, that particular text that we have created, right? So it has separated the complete text into individual words, right? Then we can find the length of the complete tokens, that is how many tokens are there, by using the length function. And you can see that there are total 70 words or tokens that are identified in NLP underscore tokens. And then we can also find the frequency of different words, that how many times a particular word is appearing in a particular paragraph, right? So for that we can find the frequency of that particular word by using the frequency distribution function from the NLTK.probabilities module, right? So we'll import the frequency dist from NLTK.probability module, and then we'll apply this frequency distance function, right? So I have dist and frequency dist. So now we have imported it and then we have used it. So we have created a object that would be used as fdist. So you can use this function by using the name fdist, and then you can give the variable that you want to count the number of variables, like, so for the words in NLP tokens, we'll find the frequency distribution, that is, we have used a shortcut for it, fdist, and then we'll provide the word dot lower. We'll convert it to lower, and then we'll convert it whatever the word, because sometimes if it is at the start of the paragraph, then the first alphabet can be capital, and in between, if natural is used, then the n will be small. So for that purpose, for avoiding that problem, we are converting all the data, all the words into lowercase, and then we'll, if it is matched over there, then we'll increase the count by one, right? So if it is there, then we'll count, increase the count by one, right? So we have created this, and you can now see that comma is appeared 5 times, the frequency distribution is given, comma is appeared 5 times, the has appeared 4 times, NLP has appeared 3 times, is 3 times, off is 3 times, and so on. So these are the count for different words in this particular text. Now if you want to find the distribution, frequency distribution of a particular word, then I have used fdist, I have represented it as fdist, so I can give the name word itself as input, and then it would give me the number of count of natural. So natural, you can see over here, it has appeared 2 times, and here also it is giving the distribution frequency as 2. Then if you want to find distinct words in the paragraph, that is, you don't want the repeated words, so you can find the this frequency distribution will give you only unique words. There won't be repeated words again multiple times. So you can find the length of this fdist that would provide you the number of unique elements or distinct words which are there in the paragraph. So there were total 70 words, and 47 among those 70 words, 47 were unique words or distinct words. They were not repeated. So selecting top 5 tokens with the highest frequency. So if you want to select the highest frequency elements from the given tokens, then you can just use the function fdist.mostcommon, and then you can give the parameter as the number of common words you want. So most common, it would obviously give you the top 5. Okay, I have given as 5 as input, so it would give the top 5. If you want 10, then you can give the parameter with most common function as 10. Would give you that kind of input. So here these first top 5 elements are 5, comma, comma, the NLP is off. So these are the 5 topmost used word in this particular date paragraph, right? Now let us have a look at different kind of tokenizers that are available in Python. There are many tokenizers that are available in Python, and one of them is again a blank tokenizer, blank line tokenizer. So it tokenizes the given text or given paragraph of text by a blank line. If there is a blank string in between, it would tokenize based on that blank screen string, right? Suppose, so again we are giving the same text, so for that we are importing blank line underscore tokenize function from the nltk.tokenize package, right? And then we are applying this to our nlp data that we have created, the paragraph, and then we'll store it in a variable as nlp underscore blank. So this is a blank line tokenizer, so whenever there is a blank line in between, it would tokenize it, right? And I have not printed it, so if you want to print it over here, you want to look at the NLP blank data, what is the content of it, then you can simply run it, and you can see that it has just bifurcated the tokens based on the blank line. So at the start, from this point, there was a new line at this particular thing, that is, there was an entry after this line, so it has separated it from this particular point. New line means backslash n, that is enter. So whenever you press an enter, it would consider it as a new line, so there would be a blank line in between. So it has bifurcated it in 3 sentences, the complete text into 3 paragraphs, right? So this is how NLP a blank or the blank line tokenizer work, right? So now if you want to count the number of paragraphs separated by blank line, new line, then you can get the new length function on this NLPK blank that would give you that there are 3 lines, as I have shown you over here itself. There are 3 different blank lines available in between, so these are 3 different lines in this paragraph. And suppose you want to view or see the content of any of these three lines. Suppose you want to view the second paragraph in this particular thing. So for that, you can use the index. You can call the NLPK underscore blank variable, and then list, it is list, and then you can give the first index, so it would print the first. So the indexing is from zero, so the first zero index will be the first sentence, one index will be the second sentence, and the two index will be the third sentence. So if you want to print the second, you will give the input parameter as one to NLP underscore token or NLP underscore blank, sorry. So NLP underscore blank of one will print the second paragraph for you. You can see that this was the second paragraph and it is printed the same. Right, and then there is concept of n-grams, bigrams and trigrams in NLTK, in NLP. These are used to create the grams of the words, that is you divide the sentence into sequence of words. Bigram is arranging the words in group of two, trigrams is in group of three, and n-grams is in group of n. For that, you can import it from the nltk.util module, the bigram, trigrams and n-grams package. And if you want to create the bigram of the given text, so you just write nlp underscore bigram and then create a list, and the list will consist of all bigrams from nlp token. So you will use the nltk.bigram function and apply it to nlp underscore token. So this will divide the given tokens into group of twos like this. So when you print it, the text, the error token, so every element of the list will be combination of two elements, that is collection of two tokens. So this is natural language. Then we'll remove the first, and then language will combine with processing, then processing will combine with the third token, fourth token, the fourth token will then combine with fifth, the fifth will combine with sixth, and so on. In this way you can create the bigrams. Similarly, trigrams is collection of three tokens at a time. So here you will start with the first, second and third token, then second, third and fourth, and third, fourth and fifth, and so on. In that way we'll create the trigrams. So this is trigram. Again, we use the nltk.trigram function for it, and it would create a group of three tokens in a list, sequence of three tokens in list. So natural language processing, then you'll remove the first and then group the second, third and fourth. So language processing comma, then you remove the second and then move with the third. So it is like a windowing kind of a thing that we apply to the text, right? Similarly, there are n-grams where you can provide the input as the number of tokens you want to combine together. So here, if I have given four, so it would make collection of four tokens together in list and then move it in a group of four, right? If you give five, then it would arrange the words in or tokens in group of five and then move one step ahead at a time. So the window of five elements will be created like that. Similarly, then there are some words called as the stop words in English. So these stop words are the words which are not required for understanding the meaning of a particular text or paragraph, right? So these stop words basically are the connectors and prepositions that are available, and they are not useful to understand the language, right? So if these words are removed from the paragraph, still you can understand the paragraph, right? So you can understand that particular paragraph without these stop words. If the basic words are there, in the more important words are there, you can just remove these stop words, and then you still the meaning of the paragraph won't change, right? So for identifying the stop word, this is kind of pre-processing which is generally done in NLP. Processing is just to reduce the efforts of identifying the meaning of particular text, right? So here for that we import the stop words from the NLTK corpus. So it consists of all the stop words, all the words that are considered to be connectors or prepositions which are considered to be stop words. So we have a stop word file in the corpus. It consists of all the stop words, right? So we just import this stop word file from the nltk.corpus, and then we set it, the stopwatch should be of type English only, English language. So there are different languages kind of thing available in this corpus. So we'll consider the stopwatch, and then we'll set these stopwords to be the only English stopwords. So stopword dot words, it will give English words, right? When you print this, it will show you the list of stopwords that belong to the language English. So these are the different, so I printed the stopwords. These are different stopwords that are available in this particular corpora. You can create your own stopword that that would consist of the words that you don't want in your particular project, right? So you can create your own corpora of stopwords, right? So these are the words that are considered to be stopword: him, most, his, with, ourselves. So doesn't, didn't, right? He, any. So these are the different words that are generally used, and they add no meaning to this particular sentence, right? Without this also you can understand the meaning of the sentence. So by using this stopword from the NLTK corpus, you can find the different stopwords, and you can remove the stopwords from the given paragraph, right? Still the meaning can be identified. So here, first of all, I'll print the NLP token, because now it is gone upwards. We'll see what are the different tokens, and this token will be now consisting of different stopwords also. But now we want to remove the stopword, because I don't have the time to read the complete paragraph. So what I'll do, I'll just remove the stopwords, and based on the remaining words, I will try to identify the different elements, or will try to understand the meaning which is present in the paragraph, which is given by the paragraph, right? So for that, first I will print the NLP tokens, and then here I created a filtered sentence, a variable, and which is a blank variable, a blank list. Then I would be adding the tokens from NLP tokens which without stopwords, right? Only the tokens which are useful, right? So I would be removing the stopwords. For that I use a for loop. For w in NLP tokens, what I'll do, if w is not in stopword, right? So if a particular word which is in NLP tokens and it is not present in stopword, so I have a stopword thing, so if this particular first word of your NLP token is not available in this set of words, then what I'll do, I'll append it to the filtered sentence list, right? So I'll append it at the end of this particular list, right? So filtered underscore sentence dot append. Append is used to combine, add a new thing to particular list. So this list was empty, so now this w will be added to the list. And this will go on until all the w's of this NLP tokens are conceived. After that, you'll get a filtered list of tokens from this sentence. And if you print it, you'll see that different stopwords from the actual existing tokens are removed. If I execute this particular thing, you can see that these were the tokens that were available in the given sentences, right? And now you can see that some of the words are removed from this. Now these are the words or tokens that are left after removing the stopwords, right? And you can see that, like, there was a word as over here, so this as is removed from here. This is was there, is removed from here. A was there, A is removed from this. So all the stop words of is to, these are removed from this particular sentence or this particular list of token, right? So these only words which are available in this particular corpora or of stop words have been removed from this. If you want that, you don't want this comma, you don't want full stop, you don't want question mark to be there in this, if you want to add it to the stopword, you can just add the list to the elements to the stopwords, and then this would also be removed from this, right? So these are the general stopwords which are given by the NLTK corpus, right? So in this way you can identify the stopword and remove it from your sentence, right? The same thing that I've done over here by writing a 3-4 lines kind of a thing, the same thing can be done in this one line only, right? So I'll assign a variable, filtered sentence, I created a variable, then here I would assign w. For w in NLP tokens, if this w is not w in stopword, if this w is not in stopword, then it would assign W to filtered sentence. This one line can do the same thing. So this is a kind of ternary function in Python, right? So it would assign this value if this particular condition is true, otherwise not, right? Then if I print this filtered sentence, so it would print the same, this the same thing over here is printed, the same thing from here is printed over here. So this command and this command will perform the same thing, right? Then we have a concept of stemming, right? So wait, so stemming is nothing but identifying the root word from the given word, right? So if a word is given, then you want to identify that which is the root word of this particular word, or from which word this particular word is generated. At that time we make use of stemming. For that, again, there are different kind of stemmers which are available in Python NLTK toolkit, and one of the stemmer which is available is a Porter stemmer. All right, so we will make use of this Porter stemmer that would identify the root word of a particular word and will display the root word, right? So from nltk.stem we'll import Porter stemmer. There are different stemmers available in NLTK. We are using the Porter stemmer. So for that I have created a short name ps. When I'll use ps, it would act as a Porter stemmer, right? So then I have created a sample words file, list of sample words related to Python. So Python is a word, Pythoning, Pythoner, Pythonly, and Python, right? So these are different words related to Python. So let us see how your Porter stemmer will identify the root word of these particular words. I have considered a for loop and considered all the element of this list, and I want to find the stem of this list. So I use the Porter stemmer dot stem function and then want the stem of W. So I created a for loop for all the words in sample words. So it would first consider Python, then Pythoning, Pythoner, Pythonly, and Python, and then it would try to find the stem word from the stem word from this particular thing by using the Porter stem. PS dot stem, and then I have given W as input, so it would try to identify the root word and will print. So you can see that Python is designed from Python, Pythoning is from Python, Pythoner is from Python, this now Pythonly is from Pythonly, this is identified. Now there are some restrictions over there, so if it has identified it as the word from Pythonly, and then Python is also from Python, so four of this is from Python and then this is for Python. So these are the rules which are created. These are functions which are created by considering a particular algorithm. So this stemmer is based on the Porter's algorithm, that is a Porter stemmer. Now the same thing you can apply. So for I have applied for this sample of words, you can apply it for any list of tokens that is available with you. So I have applied again it on the NLP underscore tokens list that we have created above. And then when I apply the Porter stemmer to find the root words, you can see that the complete words are natural is made from nature, language is made for language, processing is made from process, like this. So it has identified the token, the root word of the different words which were available in that list of tokens. Then again we have studied the concept of POS tagging, that is part of speech tagging. So for that, again there is another kind of tokenizer over here in Python, that is a Punkett sentence tokenizer that we would be using over here. So there are different kind of tokenizer, you can use any kind of tokenizer, right? So I have explained you the fourth kind of tokenizer over here, right? So for studying POS tagging, it is nothing but it identifies the part of speech of a particular token. Whether it is a noun, it is a preposition, or what kind of part of speech it belongs to, right? So if I would import, I'm importing a new file over here, State Union, which consists of the speeches of the different US presidents, right, from the last 20-30 years. So from nltk.corpus I am importing State Union, and then from nltk.tokenize I am importing Punkett's sentence tokenizer, right? And then this Punkett sentence tokenizer is unsupervised type kind of tokenizer. So you can create, you can train that by using your own file. And for that purpose, I've considered a train text, and I've considered a file of 2005 George Bush. What we say? Right. So this file consists of the George Bush speech of 2005 when he was elected. All right. His presidential speech of 2005. All right. So I have given it and stored it as a train underscore text. So I would be giving it as input for training the Punkett sentence tokenizer. For that, what I had done, I have considered the raw file of this and the state union.raw and given this as input. Similarly, for testing this, I have created a sample text file, sample underscore txt, and I have provided the 2006 speech of G.W. Bush as an input to this, right? Then I have created a custom sentence tokenizer wherein I have trained the Punkett sentence tokenizer by giving the input as the 2005 speech. Then, based on this, I have created the tokenized thing on the sample text. So I have applied custom sentence tokenizer dot tokenize. I have used this created this trained tokenizer by giving applying the tokenize function on the sample text, that is the 2006 speech of J.W. Bush. Right. For now, this particular thing for identifying the tag. Now I've created a function in Python. So for creating a function in Python, we use the def keyword. So define. Then I have created a function process underscore content, and then I have written it in try and except block, because if something went wrong, then it would give certain exceptions. Right. So inside this try block, inside exception, I have just printed the exception in string format. Right. And then in try block, what I did, I created a for loop for I in tokenized. Right. We have already created tokenized kind of thing. We have created tokens by using the Punkett's tokenizer, sentence tokenizer. Right. And then for each element in this tokenized, this will consist of different tokens element. What I've done, I have created word list, and then from an ltk.word tokenize, I have applied it to the sentence or different things that are available in tokenized, right? And then from this, I have tagged this word. So I've created a tagged list, and this tagged is nothing but it will identify the POS tagging of individual words from this tokenize thing, right? So I use the function nltk.us tag to these words. Now this tagged will consist of the list. It will arrange words and tags together. So this POS underscore tag function will identify the part of speech of the word which is under consideration, and it will assign it to tags, right? And then we'll print the tagged value, right? And here I have called this function. Unless I call this function, this is not going to execute. So here I have trained my algorithm, which is an supervised kind, and I have applied it to the sample text, and this function is now going to print the POS tagging for me, right? So you can add, you can see that the first word was president, so it is giving me NNP, that is noun, right? Then George is again a noun, then this noun, then P part of speech. So these are different things that are available. JJ is for adjective, like RB is for adverb. So these are different part of speech representations which are there in Python. Okay. Okay. So this is it. We'll see it in detail. So we have seen how we can find the part of speech of a particular text over here, right? And then now I have explained you the concept of stemming. I have explained you the concept of tokenization. I have explained you the concept of stop words. I have also explained you how you can do stemming and you can do part of speech tagging, right? So now, based on these concepts, you have to execute four practicals as given here. So the first practical says that Dr. Sabir wants to help his students to qualify the aptitude test. So in order to help them to pass through the aptitude test, Dr. Sabir wants to test their skills in English. So he decided to assign some sentences and want them to identify the key root words right from the sentences. So write a Python program that helps Dr. Sabir's student to get the root words in the sentence, right? So here you need to use the concept of tokenization and stemming. Then the second is Zara is a technical magazine editor in BIT Wardha, and one day while editing an article, she came enthusiastic about the article, but due to the limited time, she decided that to understand the article by learning about the key concepts, right? So she wants to separate the words in the sentence to know the theme of the article, as the complete article is complex to read. So write a Python program that splits the words and display both the words and their frequency in the given function using tokenizer function. Okay, so here you need to first identify, you need to first remove the stop words. Here you need to first find the frequency of particular words, right? By using this tokenizer. Then this is third and fourth. You can pause the video over here and you can read this, and you have to execute this practicals and submit it on the Moodle. This sentence or these questions are also posted on Moodle as assignment under NLP practical. You can go through that and submit your assignment as per the given deadline. Okay, thank you.